Yeah, I mean, everybody knows. But my data set was here. Yeah. It's actually just down the street.
Organize voters and provide a discussion and educational forum. utilizing the urbanism, environmental, and social equity-focused approach to advocate for creating more complete communities for current and future San Franciscans. The NDC will grow candidates and positions which support its platforms and values of the club. Thank you for joining us. And last, Mr. Toye Moses and Linda Richardson will be the attending Democratic Club. Educates unregistered voters, adds out all campaigns for new registration voters, engages and forms partnerships with organizations and other stakeholders involved in the democratic process citywide. The Willie Kennedy Democratic Club was chartered to preserve the positive memory and image of the ladies Willie Kennedy, former San Francisco City Supervisor, and the Supervisor of various leaders. Since its inception, the club has been advocating for education, economic equity, social, political, and criminal justice reform. So thank you as well. Lastly, we have people running around with sign-in sheets. We really want to collect your information because we are all going to try to activate and get more involved in the community. So if you have not signed in, please do that. We got a tablet in the back. If you haven't done it, we'll be around afterwards. The last thing, we encourage you to join all three of our clubs. We all have slightly different missions, but we are certainly all working in the same direction to try to improve the city and the communities we're all involved. And with that, I want to introduce Armand with Consistent Flats.
I'd like to introduce now our five Democratic candidates. Thank you. But a wealthy city doesn't have to be a city built on inequality, like San Francisco and District 10. A rich city should value its people, its cultures, its diversity. I'm running for District 10 seat on the Board of Supervisors because in a modern and moral society, you shouldn't have to be wealthy to be in San Francisco. I'm sick and tired of my neighbors being pushed out of the city. We've all seen it, you must be too. We deserve to have a city that isn't trying to price us out. We deserve to have a city and have homes where the land below us doesn't make us sick. We deserve to have homes for all of our neighbors. We deserve to have the opportunities at school and at work, at health and the life expectancy that other neighborhoods have. We deserve to have access to our supervisor's office every single day of the year. And now this year, we have a chance to do that. I want to go to work at City Hall every day to stand up for us, to make the city stop forcing us to choose between our jobs and our health, our city, our money, and our homes. And I want to show the neighborhood of City Hall every single day of the year for community office hours to listen, to be accountable, to help, to make sure that the work I do works for you and keeps you here. I'm Tony Kelly. I'm running for District 10 seat on the Board of Supervisors. For 15 years, I've worked as a volunteer to clean up toxic dirt out of our neighborhoods, to save and create affordable housing, to make livable neighborhoods. I'm doing that as a volunteer, and that's what we can do together, whether it's the Board of Supervisors. Thank you.
I can't afford to move on to the public housing.
continue to fight to make sure that our transportation is improved and adequate. I look forward to this debate this evening so that you can see that you have some good candidates here, but only one is accomplished the outcomes that we need in order to be successful in all of our communities. And that's me, Shamann Walton. Thank you for being here.
Soil where they thought it was clean before. We've seen this movie before, we've seen it in Special Island.
and we can do better in the public. Here are four things the Board of Supervisors can do today and could have done any day for the last 10 years to make this thing up better. One, restore the Restoration Advisory Board. It's the only community oversight body over the cleanup that exists. Instead of mandated, the state government is in 2009. Bring it back to the city offices and make it part of the rules that nothing gets transferred without the back signing off on. Second, the problem is that we're trying to sell land and clean it up at the same time. That causes tremendous effort to cut corners. Clean all of it, stop construction and clean all of it, then sell. So not just testing, cleaning the entire site. Third, OCII, Office of Community Investment and Infrastructure, has full authority over all decisions for land use to clean up the shipyard. We have community authority back to the Board of Supervisors. Oversight over OCII at the board. And fourth, we all want that next contract for data to be canceled. What contract does the city have with that attack? They need to cancel with us too, or should we have teeth in our face?
Words. home. Also, there's been a lot of development already, specifically Alice Griffin projects. They were redone one phase. They're having transportation problems way out there. The people by the shipyard, they're having transportation problems out there. So I would definitely work on District 10 not being ignored as usual and get some better transportation for us.
So first off, the T-train sucks. I'll agree on that. But I'll get back to that in a minute. I think one of the positive things that we have is the infrastructure. So if you look at the way transit is set up in this neighborhood, we've got the north-south connection down, right? The infrastructure for T-train is successful there. If you look at our regional connectivity, we've got Caltrain, that goes down to the peninsula. The infrastructure is there. But we've got to get this T-train in, right? The T-train has been in existence for a little over 10 years now. Raise your hand if you think you've seen any economic sort of benefit of T-train. Exactly. So three simple things that I think can happen fairly soon if the investments are made the right way. The first is very, very simple that we've asked for years, signal overrides. It is simple. If I'm driving in my car at a red light, I should not look over at the T-train also waiting at the red light. That's an issue. The second thing is limiting the switchbacks. After a Giants game, like Ms. Berry mentioned, you can't get service in on Bayview. That's not equitable. The last thing is we need to make sure during peak times that there are more cars. There's just one T-car train that goes during the morning and the afternoon, so making sure we add an extension to make sure that there are two cars to service the rest of the neighborhood. The last thing I will say is the historic E-line, making sure we provide as much service to Dogpatch, to Bayview, to Visitacion Valley as possible. Thank you.
Right.
The big problems we had in the eastern neighborhoods and the rezoning for Mission, Potrero, and Dogpatch was that we transit-oriented development. We can't have transit-oriented development without transit, but yet that's what we have. As a population development, Dogpatch, Potrero, Triple, perhaps, so we go to public housing, and we have no new bus lines. So everyone's moving in the cars, and we have H times the asthma rate of other parts of the city. So we are literally choking on our growth. So we need to actually get value out of development and actually pay for the infrastructure. When the Eastern neighborhood was being considered, we almost got that. We almost got a portion of the property taxes to go to the infrastructure in the neighborhood. The mayor at the time had to do something, the controller vetoed that, and the board approved it anyway, and we've seen the effects today in the lack of transit in the neighborhood. Now, thanks to the Throw Boosters, the Throw Democratic Club, and a lot of work we had in the Throw Dogpatch, we're on the verge of getting finally getting two new bus lines to serve a huge population in the neighborhood. But it's been a long time coming. So, what to do in the future? We actually need to get that extracted value from new development of coming rezoning that's coming up on Thursday. In this valley, you get part of that value map for transit infrastructure out of that development, out of the property taxes of that development. And one reason I've been a primary supporter of public banking. Since this 2009, because we should use our city reserves in long-term ways, less interest, and put it into infrastructure development and affordable housing.
Just to make a left turn on Connecticut. So sometimes we have
Well, Missouri is 150% correct, just in terms of what we've seen happen for 53 hours of the director of the government resource center. The city decided to take 53 routes out. Just imagine being a parent, trying to get your kids to and from school, trying to go grocery shopping, trying to do the things from day to day, and they're done in the bus. We need someone who is a leader, one who never let anything like that happen take place in our center. The second thing, something like that does, is we need to turn it because we bring the community together to fight against any injustice like this. We need to expand the team. We need to bring more express buses into our city that run through our community to connect to commercial, to connect to commercial corridors, to connect people to jobs in the rest of San Francisco, and to make sure that people don't have to do like I do. When I live in San Francisco, I'm a member of the Board of Education. I have to drive everywhere I go. So if I have a meeting in Bayview, if I have a meeting downtown, if I have a meeting at the school district, get back to Bayview, I have no choice but to drive because of our inadequate transportation. In the district and in the entire community, express buses are the least expensive way to address that right away. Now, I'm going to say something that might shock some of you that is going to be expensive, but if we vote for me on November 6th, I'm going to be continuing to vote for him so we can have less traffic on our streets, more bicycles, more cycling, and the team will go underground and it'll be a smoother transportation for all of us. But right now, express buses.
I've seen that a lot of decisions that are made are
Poverty level housing.
We also need to make sure that we have more food pantries in our district that provide quality food for families that need more support and need more help so that they can have nutritious meals in their homes. We're doing it within the school district and changing where we get our food from and how our food is processed. We need to do the same thing for our families and community. It really comes down to informing the community about the negative impacts of some of the choices they have made, providing grocery stores and quality produce in our rest, in the rest of our district and all of our neighborhoods for District 10, and making sure that we take care of the families that need more support by having more food parents, having more lunch options in all of our communities. That's something that I've done as a director of children from the resource center.
Why can't we have adequate health care?
The last thing I want to mention is hunger. I met with a group of pastors last week, and we talked about what's the number one issue for seniors in their congregation. Guess what they said? Hunger. It is appalling that if we cannot provide food for our seniors, what are we doing? What are we doing at City Hall? What are we doing in our neighborhoods? The last thing I would add is this neighborhood needs a grocery store. We've been talking about this for 20 years, 30 years. I got the perfect place to put it, 1550 X.
Well, I checked the news and the scare was already over, but I had a flashback because I went through a tsunami
absolutely 100% less. Why? Because the police that we have now have not met any of the, have not met all the reforms recommended by the Justice Department. Also, they have not met the recommendations met by the Blue Ribbon Panel. We have more police that aren't in these reform stages. That means more problems for people in District 10. We all know this. We've had multiple police murders in District 10 with the district attorney who will not press charges against any of these officers. And the statistics show the newer officers are the ones that do this type of thing. So no, I'd like to see community policing on.
More policing, no more less.
Yes,
so I would say this. I'm sure that everybody has seen the crazy reports of 30,000 car break-ins across the city of San Francisco. Insane. We know the hotspots, right? We know where these car break-ins are happening. So what I would like to see is more community policing models. I want to see officers out of their cars, walking the beat. I want to see officers attending community meetings. I want to see officers do things like Officer JJ, who recently took a group of students to Africa. We've got to sort of dispel this myth and see people for who they are. Trips like that do exactly that. During my time at the San Francisco Human Rights Commission, we work with not only the police department, but other community organizations to make sure that the police are following the 272 Department of Justice recommendations. That's definitely important. But we don't want the police to over-police. Right? We want to make sure that they understand and that they live in the communities that they serve, and that they are talking to folks on the human level. At the end of the day, we want to make sure the police are talking to folks and living and attending community meetings in the communities that they're working.
Some of Gloria left our farmers. Captain Ford made the statement and said this, that safety is not more cops. Safety is fewer reasons to call cops. Now think about that. Anyone that means where our city budget is going, what to do it, right? Anyone remembers Captain Rick Bruce? If I remember community policing working and having friendly or contact with the police, where they're not chasing them. At this point, with all, how many police scandals do you want? How many police scandals can I list in 90 seconds for us to make it? At this point, it's not a friendly or contact with the PD, it's fewer contact with the PD until they can prove that they are better. We need to make them better. They're the best neighborhood enforcement country known, and they're the best enforcement country. And they need to earn their salaries. But also, this is a way from Captain Ford, never Captain before, to continue these things from waves over the years. Think about how many crimes are committed, small and large, in the city, that happen simply because kids have nothing better to do that much. So, going to the root causes of crime, trying to deal with poverty, structural racism, over-incarceration, intimidation, not from the police and from the schools and from the rest of our system. That's actually the quickest solution to our crime problems. Free City College is the quick solution to our crime problems, rather than more cops.
To the police.
The data will tell you that more skill sets the young person has, the better they will do, and the better decisions they will make. And so our role in the community, and what I've been fighting for so long, is to make sure that our young people have an opportunity to make decisions so that they don't have so much of this content. The reality is we need more community policing strategies, more community policing strategies in our community. Police attending Willie's grants, police attending chances, and being a fabric of the community. And we know that if police are present, crime will not be committed. But if relationships are built between police and community, that also deters crime. And it also gets our police involved with neighbors on the day to day. So when you know somebody's grandma, when you know somebody's auntie, when you know somebody's uncle, you have a different relationship with that community. A lot of that is changing because a lot of our officers are not in our community anymore. So I'm proposing that we provide resources for officers to come to the community on all hands, participate in things, and spend time in our communities to get to know our community. Right now, we're also working on the community safety initiative. Every year, the young people connect with careers in the public sector, within the court system, within the police department, within the sheriff's department, within the health probation, within the public defender's office. So they can get to know the people who work in our city, and
this will be the last question from me, not from the audience, and then we'll begin to ask each other questions. This question, written admirably, given the many challenges our district 10 residents face, will you stop marijuana dispensaries? So we'll start with you.
So on one hand, cannabis is legal. So our
disease. So liquor stores and bars. And there is a process for the approval of liquor stores and bars and pharmacies. It's a conditional use process. And you have various conditions for approval for a certain site. It's a very clear process, and one of those conditions is often community support. So I see no problem with the benefit in that process. And so if the dispensary or the facility or anything having to do with cannabis demonstrates community support, various community benefits, whatever conditions to be in conditional use, the planning commission does, the planning department does, then depending on that support, and depending on that particular use of that particular site, the planning commission can then use discretion to approve. It's actually a perfect line of process for all these other types of uses that are in some controversial data, as you know, by the way, that's what we're saying, right? And that gives the community more voice and support for the public.
So I think the first thing that needs to happen is we've got to expand on our equity program. We have seen people of color, folks affected by this war on drugs, fall short thus far in this program. We've got to expand this. It's not just the retail locations. It's everything that goes into the science of cannabis. The second piece is that I really, really worry about, Uzuri touched on this, is this cannot be the same thing that happened with the liquor store. We can't have a dispensary on every other block. Look at this district, the dispensary that's up here in this park. You look at the one in Dogpatch, and then you look at the one in Visitacion Valley. How many did they want to open up in Dogpatch? Maybe one or two. How many did they want to open up in Vis Valley?
Four.
That is a six or seven, you might be right, I might have missed it all. But that's just not right. We've got to make sure that communities of color are not disproportionately affected by this industry any longer.
Thank you.
we're supposed to be doing this. Let me just first say it is a tremendous honor to sit up here with each of you. I'm just a kid from Bayview, down on 3rd and Blue. And for me to be able to actively, aggressively take part in this public process, I'm truly honored to do that with four other people who have committed their lives to public service. It's a blessing. So I would give yourself a round of applause. To be honest, I have not thought about that yet. For me, I am focused on making sure that I'm addressing issues in District 10. I'm making sure that I'm on the phone, raising money, making sure that we're in the field, knocking on doors. As soon as I do come to that conclusion, I would be more than happy to let you personally know.
Experience on living in the city and bring our families with you.
How's the guy's poetry? You think the city's on the right track, man? If you represented the city hall? We all know friends that have pushed out San Francisco. And if we don't change radically and work much more, much harder to keep us here, a lot of us, without one of the buzzies that we've had most of the last 10 years, a lot of us, families, workers, artists, tenants, and immigrants, we're not going to be here. And we're going to be a canteen for a really freezing pool or something. So we have a choice this November. We can double down again on systemic racism and inequality of city hall policies, where we can finally use our budget, our land, our power, our opportunity, and justice for everyone. No, we're not going to get that change in politicians. We need an advocate. We need an advocate with the experience, the values, and commitment to stand up for us and for our neighborhoods instead of big developers, big companies, and big banks. For better oversight over the shipyard and the police department, and against politicians who say anything and do nothing, and who won't push the massive change our city needs. I'm the only candidate for the corporate free campaign. I'm taking contributions from developers, for lobbyists, but we have people. We've got 10,000 voters already. We have 1,000 voters in support already. And I got 1,000 signatures from people who yelled about it. I got 1,000 signatures from District 10 voters in 23 days, far faster than any other campaign in the city. Come join us on the supervisor.com.
Outcomes for our students in our schools. Only one person is assured that we're building two new schools in our eastern neighborhoods. Two new schools. We've got a fully funded group on that happened under my presidency, under the Board of Education. And I agree with everyone up here. We need an advocate in City Hall. Someone who has a track record of fighting against elected officials, or fighting against developers, or fighting against anybody. They're absolutely right. I have op-eds that demonstrate that. I have results that demonstrate that. I am someone who is going to fight for the people that elect me to serve them. I'm the only one up here who can say I've been elected to office and it's actually accessible. Most of this room has my cell number. Most of this room sends me email and knows that I respond. I'll come out to your neighborhood. I'll come out to your community. We need someone who actually has the ability to help the leadership to see to get things done. I want to represent you because I have that ability and I have proven it time in and time out. Thank you.
We owe it to the social workers. We
go to the single mothers, to the firefighters, to the laborers, to the service worker. We fight so hard to keep this city afloat, but can't afford to live here. I am not running for supervisor to be something. I'm running to do something. Thank you very much.
That the choices that District 10 residents